Well, a boy's best friend is his mother.
Kill her, Mommy. Kill her.
We'll tear your soul apart.
Live or die. Make your choice.
What are you waiting for, huh? What are you waiting for?
I'm not even gonna swat that fly. I hope they are watching. They'll see. They'll see and they'll know. And they'll say, why, she wouldn't even have a fly.
I met this 6-year-old child with this blank, pale, emotionless face. The blackest eyes. The devil's eyes. I spent 8 years trying to reach him, and then another 7 trying to keep him locked up because I realized that what was living behind that boy's eyes was purely and simply evil.
Dracula.
Well, to my home.
Anxiously expecting you.
All right, hello everyone, and welcome to an episode of Back to the Blockbuster with your host Gaius and Jackson. Still using the intro for Gaius and Jackson because Jackson is still very much part of the show, but he is busy with classes, and he is disappointed that he is busy with classes, because when we did Tales of Horror last year, he was pretty stoked on it, wanted to be involved a bit more than he, like he was last year, but he has some priorities that are kind of getting in the way of that, but he will be on for a few Tales of Horror episodes that we did schedule in advance to kind of work with his schedule. But in the meantime, this is the second Tales of Horror episode we're recording this year. I did one yesterday for Psycho 2. And for this one, we have a really fun movie. I have another movie I haven't really discussed on the show at all ever. So that's why I was really excited that this was the pick. And we are introducing Ryan Joseph Murphy of the Your Horror Show podcast, who picked this particular film. So thank you for joining me on this one.
Thanks so much for having me, man. It's a pleasure to be here. I really appreciate it.
Nice. I was very happy when we do these, because it's basically almost like cold calling, except for like cold messaging people that want to be on for this. And I'm happy to say that most people are really responsive and want to do it, because it's really nice to kind of help each other out. And kind of the
who doesn't want to talk about horror? Come on, are you kidding me?
That's who doesn't want to talk about this stuff? Yeah, I always say too, when I was pitched to do a podcast, and I really wanted to do a horror movie podcast, but at the time I had co-hosts that were not into horror movies, so we just made it like a general like kind of movie podcast. And what's interesting is that those co-hosts have since left. The guy who is usually on with me, he's been on for a little over a year. He loves horror movies, and I'm like, oh, I kind of wish you were on from the beginning, because I would have totally made this a horror movie podcast. But I mean, this is why we kind of came up with this to do for the month of September and October, because it gives us a chance to kind of turn the podcast into a little bit of a horror movie podcast a bit, at least for these 2 months. So, I mean, I love talking horror movies. It seems like you like talking horror movies. The good thing about Tales of Horror is, more so than the movie that you pick, we want to introduce listeners to you and how you got started and what your podcast is about. So whatever you want to share with everyone, go right ahead, because I want to know more about. I did look to your stuff a bit, but yeah, anything that you want to share, feel free.
Yeah, thanks so much, man. I really appreciate it. So yeah, I got into kind of podcasting audio stuff right around the time of the pandemic. I don't know if people remember when Clubhouse, that app, was a thing. It yep. feels like so long ago. But I got into Clubhouse, which was an audio only app, and I quickly met a bunch of people that wanted to do live table reads of films with sound cool. and music. And we were like, hey, this is cool. I'm an actor. I'm based in LA. And I was looking for creative things to do. And I love the horror genre. And we started to get into doing these live table reads, and we did one of Scream, the original Scream film, which I absolutely love. And we did it with Tori Spelling playing the part of Neve Campbell. So that was a really fun kind of like role reversal, because she's in the second movie as the double in Stab. So she played, yeah. in this fun table read she did, she played the role of Neve, which she auditioned for actually for Wes Craven. And then, we had other people in that table read as well, including Josh Rubin, who directed the film Just Scare Me and also Werewolves Within. We also had Noah Segan, who's been a lot of Rian Johnson's movies in there. We had my friend Sarah Nato Cheney, who is the voice of Ash Ketchum from Pokemon in there playing Gale. So we had like a really fun cast of fun, talented actors. And then we continued to do that. We did one table read of Get Out, where Monkey Paw actually was in the audience listening to it, and they sent us a message saying it was great. Then we did one on Friday the 13th with Christina Klebe and Kelly Maroney and other really awesome horror actors as well. And then, our little troupe got recruited actually to do a live walkthrough haunted house experience for Reddit, when Reddit was trying out their kind of like live talk feature. And that was heard by about 40,000 people. So that was really cool. Okay. And slowly but surely, I wanted to get into podcasting. I was like, I love audio storytelling. I love doing this. And, before the pandemic, I had done my own horror shorts, and effectively was this anthology series. I love anthology horror. That's my favorite type of horror. I love like Tales from the Crypt is one of my favorite shows of all time. Twilight Zone, the original incarnation. Are You Afraid of the Dark? All of these great anthology series. And so I ended up, doing these horror shorts before the pandemic called Welcome to the Horror Show, with my kind of host character, Mr. Graves, introducing these things. We did three shorts. And then, we were pitching that to stuff, but obviously the pandemic hit and it kind of fell apart, unfortunately. But I took this idea and I was like, I want to do this as a anthology horror podcast, and it's called Your Horror Show Now. And so we have about 18 real episodes out right now. We just passed about 32,000 downloads just recently, which was cool. So people have been starting to find the show and really liking it. And every story is kind of its own thing. We have some that are like space horror. We have some that are like a hitman is being, stalked by a ghost that he killed. every episode is kind of its own thing. It's all very much pulpy. It's based like kind of on this idea of the EC Comics, the Tales from the Crypt world. So if your listeners or anyone who's hearing this are interested in it, please feel free to give it a check it out, because we put a lot of time and effort into it. We're really excited. We'll have three episodes coming out in the month of October, including our second Halloween special. Really excited to get that out there. But I just love audio storytelling in general. And I think, horror is just this absolute amazing genre, ripe for telling just incredibly fun stories. And so I'm really excited for us to talk about the film that we have today too, because it's one of my favorites.
This is kind of what Tales of Horror is all about. Just hearing your background and how you got into it, just like, I feel like I get very lucky finding some of the people we get to talk to for this, because it goes if we've gotten lucky where it runs much deeper than just, you know, creating podcasts and having fun with it. There, you know, the what you talked about and how you got started is so interesting, and the people you gotten to do things with, it sounds really interesting too. So I mean I love that you've been able to share that and like to see how your podcast has grown since then. So yeah, that's really exciting to hear, man. I'm stoked. That's awesome.
appreciate it. So that's, yeah, really cool. Should I reveal the movie that we're talking about today?
Yes, go ahead. I mean, I want to say first, what's been cool this year is I love the stuff that we did last year. A lot of the stuff we did, because it was new, we picked a lot of movies that were kind of, you know, popular and on the nose, like, and some had anniversaries, like some like Urban Legend and stuff like that, which are fun. They were fun to talk about, but every choice so far that people have picked has been very different this year, and this is one of them, and I'm pretty excited about it. I think I've only mentioned this movie once on our show in a reference to the director, and that actually is fairly recent that we brought it up, but yeah, I'm really excited to get into it. So yeah, let's let the listeners know which movie you picked.
I mean, I think this is an absolute gothic horror classic. I mean, I if you're talking about just like this, the dripping atmosphere, the bright and amazing colors, the like the hammy, over the top, incredible acting. I mean, you can't get any better than Bram Stoker's Dracula, directed by Francis Ford Coppola. Absolute banger of a horror film, and definitely one to watch during spooky season.
Yeah, definitely want to watch during spooky season. I hadn't watched it in a really long time. I think I was telling you that I had the 4K that they sent to me. It was still wrapped up. I haven't even opened it yet, because like a lot of times we get movies and kind of set them aside and like, yeah, I'll get to them eventually. And sometimes it'll be almost like a year. I'm like, oh, wow, I didn't open that. So I was happy to open it for this and pop it in. And it had been a really long time since I'd seen it. And you are completely on the nose with like, how do you describe it? It is the cinematography. It looks beautiful, especially in 4K. It looks great. Cinematography is great. I have to agree with you on the acting too. It is, some of it is very hammy, but it works for the, you know, for the content, I guess. There's one person in particular that I know critics are really hard on in the movie, that we'll probably talk about in a little bit more detail. But I don't know. I think Francis Ford Coppola accomplished what he wanted to accomplish with it. And I was reading what other people thought about the movie before we did this. And this is one, I think, that a lot of retrospective reviews has gotten better reviewed, even more so than when it came out. And they consider it responsible for the kind of resurgence in these kind of movies. You know, we had like, you know, Wolf and Mary Riley and Interview with the Vampire. So they kind of credit this with, you know, letting studios know that, you know, these kind of gothic horror films could be successful at the box office and with critics. So, yeah, I would like to know, do you recall when you first saw it?
So I actually remember seeing this. I didn't see it right when it came out. I was young still, I think, because if I remember correctly, it was 1991, correct?
92,
correct. Yeah. Okay, so 92. Yeah, so I was 5. So I didn't see it right when it came out. I actually do, funny enough though, remember playing the Super Nintendo version of this game when it was out as a kid. And there was a fun, the image.
Everything
on the
had a video game back then, yeah, right?
Yeah, everything had a video game tie-in, exactly. No, but I remember watching, I believe when I was 7 or 8, I watched it because I had seen, my dad had showed me Dracula Dead and Loving It, which was the parody version of effectively of this film that Mel Brooks did, which is hilarious. And so I went back and I rewatched this film and I just immediately fell in love with it and just absolutely enjoyed every, you know, again, no movie's perfect, but there's right. So many great moments in this film where there's just, it's, you know, it ramps up the original Dracula story so hard. And like it's the makeup effects, the cinematography, the atmosphere. I mean, this is one where I just feel like it's just ramped up to 11. And to some extent, I wish that Coppola had done more horror films, because I think that his style is very akin to doing a great horror film. But obviously he's concerned with other things, which is fine. But at the end of the day, I still think this is just one of those movies that is like you said, the the rewatchability of it is very high. And the fact too, that there were so many incredible actors in this film. And I would say 90% of them give fantastic performances in this film.
Yeah. That was one of the other impressive. This is a very much, as far as like when certain people were really emerging and becoming really popular, like certain actors of their time who are still working today and doing great work, but you know, they Francis Ford Coppola talked about casting Keanu Reeves, for example, and who got his fair share of criticism when the movie was released, and like might still get it. You know, Francis Ford Coppola admits they hired him because they wanted like a marquee, like kind of like good looking actor to be in the movie. And he was that at the time. And Keanu Reeves even admits that he thinks he could have been better. He had come off doing like a lot of movies in a row when he did this and felt that he just wasn't up to par. I mean, like, but then you had like Winona Ryder, who was really big in the, you know, and at this point in her career. And it's like a little perfect storm. And then there was just some actors that I just didn't recognize. Like when I was watching it, I mean, I knew that they were in it, but then I was like, you know, like, oh, there's Cary Elwes. And like, oh, there's Billy Campbell. Like, you know, Richard E. Grant. Like, there's just like so many great people in it, in addition to people like Gary Oldman and Anthony Hopkins. So yeah, it's like the perfect storm of like, you know, the kind of ensemble cast I think that you want for a movie like this for the most part.
Well, and I don't know if you do this too, that the insider baseball on Winona Ryder being cast in this film was actually the fact that she dropped out of Godfather 3. And so she was slated to be in that film in the Sofia Coppola role. And, you know, her and Coppola had been talking and talking about trying to work together. So she had to drop out of that. She was exhausted. And so Coppola actually approached her and said, what do you want to do? Like, what type of film do you want to make? And she said, she actually came across a script for Dracula. And she said, well, I just read this and I absolutely love it. And so she actually gave it to Coppola, and Coppola said, oh yeah, this is really good. This is really, really good. And it was the adaptation effectively of the book, you know, a bit more horror centric, a bit more gothic focused. And he really liked it. And that was kind of the genesis of you know, Winona Ryder accepting that role and then them working together. And that was what kind of kicked off the production effectively.
Oh, that's cool. So this kind of all starts with her like dropping out of one of his movies and then, you know, finding something that, you know, him being like, find something that you want to do together. And this is what she found. And that's how that all came. That's pretty cool. And she kind of had that pull back then too, to kind of be able to do that, to have her choice of what she wanted to do, the choice of people that she wanted to work with. Cause she, you know, from the late 80s through like, I guess mid 90s, she was like the thing.
That point. She was a huge, she had just come off Edward Scissorhands. She had come off a couple of other really big films. And so, she was the it girl at the time.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I actually did not know that's how that all came together, but that's interesting. And that how that all worked out for her too. That's awesome.
And I was going to say too, she was actually the one too. She pitched a lot of the actors actually for this film. She pitched Gary Oldman. She pitched Anthony Hopkins. I don't believe she pitched Keanu Reeves. That was not one of hers, but a couple of those actors, she was actually pitching to Coppola as like, oh, these are actors that I think could play some of these parts. And so I think that was really interesting too.
Yeah, I do love this like idea of like Winona Ryder being at the height of her powers, just to just be like, I want to work with this person and that person, and you know, have a wish list and get them, you know, for the most part. That's awesome. It's so cool too, because like, you know, she had a career that was like really hot, and then of course she had her, you know, fair share of stuff that happened. And it's pretty cool to see that she's been back, you know, recently, like fairly recently, you know, with Stranger Things and all the stuff she's been doing. So it's good to see that, you know, there is kind of like a comeback vehicle for like most of these people that had a moment back in the day, and they can kind of come back and still be successful. That's awesome.
I think it's interesting too, because there was a lot of onset also tension between her.
I did and hear that.
And it's funny because in the film, the chemistry they have is actually great. I think it works extremely well. And it's believable, but you know, on the other side of that equation was, you know, supposedly they had a great time together during rehearsals and like kind of like reading the script together and all of that. But then once they got to set, there was, I guess, a moment somewhere on set where things turned super sour, super quick. And immediately she was like, they were both like, we're not friendly anymore. And so effectively they were doing their scenes and then they would completely never talk to each other on the set, which is so interesting.
That's so crazy to me. I mean, because they do have really good chemistry and then they have to be in scenes where they are so intimately close to each other and have to be connected on a real. This is interesting too, because yesterday we did Psycho 2 and they had a similar problem where Anthony Perkins and Meg Tilly didn't get along while filming it, and their scenes together in the movie you wouldn't notice at all, but they get along so much that he wanted her fired, and she's still to this day said it's one of the worst experiences she's had as an actress, and she didn't even go to the premiere. But you don't really notice it on screen at all, and I definitely didn't notice it with Renona Ryan and Gary Oldman because their chemistry is pretty on point. But I always have to feel like how awkward it must be to. I mean, you have to be professional, do your scenes, and it is a job, but like having to go in your separate quarters once they're done because you're like, you can't stand to be around the person. That is very interesting to me.
Yeah, I can't imagine doing that. I mean, as an actor myself, it's a hard situation to get through where you just like cannot stand somebody, but you, like you said, you got to just be professional in the moment. You deliver a great performance and then it kind of gets washed away. Afterwards, it's kind of now Hollywood gossip at this point, after the film does well and kind of lives on its legacy. But it's an interesting dynamic for sure.
Yeah, for sure. What continues to kind of stand out? As you've gotten older and seen the movie probably multiple times, what do you think still continues to stand out about it?
Yeah, I think first off, we have a couple of very iconic Dracula performances throughout history, right? We have Bela Lugosi's, right. We could even go to Max Schreck as Nosferatu, as Count Orlok in Nosferatu. It's still an iconic performance, even if it's not technically Dracula, plagiarism, whatever. After that, you get Bela Lugosi, who is kind of the first iconic, truly iconic Dracula. And obviously that performance kind of is still permeated throughout history. And then after that, you get Christopher Lee, who is another iconic performance of Dracula and has this kind of resurgence, through the Hammer horror films. And then lastly, I think the last truly iconic performance of Dracula is Gary Oldman. I think that he is like I think more than any other Dracula, he kind of tapped into the fact that he is this longing character who in reality is a tragic kind of like monster. And so I don't think Dracula truly had ever been played as well of that type of character before this film. So every time I watch it, I notice that kind of like tragic romance, that tragic character. I think the creature effects in this film are also like extremely awesome. You have one of the coolest kind of like werewolf transformations ever in a vampire movie. You have, the brides of Dracula, who not only are extremely attractive, but terrifying. That's just very cool. You also have, a plethora of scenes, again, we talk about the atmosphere of just the castle itself, the way it looks, the gothic, kind of London, the London streets and everything, the costumes in this. I just think it's just such a grand opera of like gothic atmosphere that you get throughout this movie. And so whenever I watch it, those are the things that always stick out to me. It gives you a vibe. And it's interesting because I feel like in our current film culture, where, a film like Long Legs to me is a little bit more style than substance. I feel like this film would have done extremely well in the modern day with what we kind of have with the color palettes and, film Twitter loves this movie. Right. But I do think every time I watch it, I zero in on that. And then Anthony Hopkins's performance of Van Helsing too is great. I mean, he's unhinged. He's fun. He's, we mainly get Van Helsing in the past Dracula films is kind of this hoity-toity professor. He's not he's kind of like too smart for everybody, but he's not really a fighter. And then in this film, he's very much like in the thick of things. He's in the battle with them and he's like, he's combating Dracula with them. So I think that was also a different change as well.
Yeah, I agree with you. And, going back to Gary Oldman, I think, he, he elicits your sympathy, despite the fact that, I mean, on, because on paper, you know, he is basically trying to isolate Mina, like, you know, get Jonathan Harker out of the way, kind of get her like safety nets all out of the way so he can isolate her and, you know, do what he needs to do to kind of convince her, like, you know, that she is, you know, his, like, forever, right? So on one hand, he is a monster, but he does a lot in that performance that, despite all of those things and all the things that he's doing, I felt for him throughout the entire movie. And that has to do a lot with Gary Oldman's performance, because it, you know, I don't think any actor could really do that. And I kind of agree. I think that I can't think of a person who's done this role since him that has done it this kind of justice. And I think that's a very hard balance to find, like, the sympathy in that role, and then also still maintain this sense of evil too, because he does have a sense of menace, and you do see it during different parts of the movie. But he finds the right balance, and I don't think that's easy to do in this role, but he definitely does it.
Because I'm trying to rack my brain right now too about, like, you know, we've obviously had Dracula films since this, and we've had kind of different incarnations of Dracula in various forms, but I don't really think anyone has tapped into since this role that, like, kind of like the gravitas that the role actually, like, maintains. Yeah. And again, it's like, you know, you can point to, like, Nick Cage plays him in Renfield. You're like, yeah, I mean, it was kind of hokey and fun. I mean, it is what it is. You can, Gerard Butler played him in Dracula 2000, which was kind of like this schlocky, you know, Wes Craven joint that is just kind of feels like half-assed thrown together. And, you know, you look at, like, some of the other incarnations. Obviously, we have Nosferatu coming out this year, you know, from Robert Eggers, or it's next year. I don't remember. Yeah, it's this year.
Yeah, in the year.
Yeah, and so you have some different incarnations coming out, but again, I just, you know, we have to remember too, like, Gary Oldman is a revered actor even at that time, and it's like also thinking about now, I'm not sure who's out there that you're like, oh yeah, he would just do amazing justice to Dracula. Like, it's a very interesting role, and it's not a role necessarily that always goes to, like, the actor who's the best looking or the most it goes to an actor that's really got an idea of what kind of this character needs and how to showcase it differently. I did like there was a BBC version of Dracula that they did, I think, in the last 5 years, that I thought was really fun. And I thought they did a good job at that, but still not as quite as, like, the overall performance that Gary Oldman gives, I think, is just, like, iconic.
Yeah, I agree. And like you said, there is a gravitas to it. He has the look down, like, you know, and getting to play different versions of him too. I mean, I think that is, that he kind of excels in, like, you have the old version of him that we meet when he is around Keanu Reeves's character. And then, of course, the younger version when he needs to, like, be able to seduce Mina. And even in the beginning when he's just kind of like this, like, warrior as well. And, like, so, like, there, he has to play so many different shades of this part and be able to tap in so many different emotions. And he's able to do all of them, like, seamlessly. And I kind of wonder, I mean, I don't, you can maybe tell me this, like, when people do talk about Gary Oldman's performance, is this mentioned in, like, the grand pantheon of, like, great stuff he's done?
I feel like it is. I mean, I feel like, you know, when we talk about Gary Oldman, I feel like when we bring up his performances, I feel like, you know, we always have to bring up The Professional. I think that's right. Always mentioned there, because just even for the everyone, you know, just even for that, like, gif. But I feel like that one's always included. I think that, you know, I'm not sure if his performance or if it's his look in Fifth Element that gets mentioned more, like, that idea of, like, if it's just his look or if it's actual, like, performance in that movie. But I think that one always gets mentioned. But I mean, to me, I'm like, this is either a top three or top five Gary Oldman performance. I mean, I can't, you know, again, like you said, the fact too that we got the Vlad Tepes Dracula, and that I want to say this is one of the first films ever to really explore that side of Dracula, because most of the time it just starts with him already in the castle. He's old, and that's where you kind of start with it. But the movie did a great job of showcasing the history behind what was Dracula before that, and that I feel like it has led the way as well. That legacy of, you know, Dracula Untold, of having those origin story films of Dracula that were, like, trying to explore that aspect of him. But this film kind of does it in a very quick, fun, you know, kind of epically cinematic way. Right. But like you're saying, there's so many shades to this Dracula in the film. And I'm thinking about Gary Oldman's film, you know, his filmography, which is vast and has incredible performances. But the fact that he plays effectively four different versions of Dracula in this movie, I mean, it's hard for me to like argue against this being a top three performance of his career. It's really hard for me to do that.
Yeah, he really, in every scene, he like makes himself the center of attention, and like he's just so good. And I think he honestly, you know, you spoke on the chemistry he has with Winona Ryder. I think he makes her better in a lot of scenes too when they're together as well. I think she's fine in the movie on her own, but I think she kind of really comes, like, there's a certain chemistry she has with him, and then there's the chemistry that she supposed to have with the guy she's supposed to marry, the Keanu Reeves character, and she definitely comes alive. And I mean that could just be the manner of the story too, because she's more enticed by Dracula in the movie. But she definitely, there are certain, I think, actors that make their scene partners better, and I think that is the case here. Even if they didn't like each other, they definitely brought, I mean, the best out of each other, I thought.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And again, it's one of those situations where, you know, look, they're both professionals. They're both talented performers, and they were going to do what was necessary. But I mean, again, the chemistry in the film is undeniable. There's some great scenes with them together, and her like kind of resisting or kind of like being pulled into his trance, and them having this kind of dance of like sensuality, and you know, the film really exploring those themes of, you know, kind of closeted, repressed sexual energy in that time in London, and these women who, you know, clearly, you know, wanted to be sexual, but because of the restraints of that time period, they could not be. And the idea right. that this immigrant who comes into their world starts kind of like showcasing that it's okay to do this is very kind of interesting and a great thematic kind of like through line throughout the film.
Yeah. And I, you know, you mentioned that you saw this young. I saw this young too. I mean, I was born in 84, but I was maybe 7 or 8 when I first saw this, probably too young to still watch it. It's so crazy because when I was watching it, the scene I still remember the most when I was younger, for some reason, it's the scene where he's the young version of himself, and he finally sees her and they meet each other for the first time. They've had these conversations, and then he makes a comment about to like not fear him, and then he kind of pulls her away, and it's almost like this kind of floating dance they almost do where he kind of pulls her away where he's going to like, you know, eventually like turn her or bite or whatever. And that's the scene I remember the most when I was a kid, and that still stands out to me a lot from watching the movie when I was younger. And when I watched it for this, it was like almost a total recall to like that particular moment I was young. I don't know why that scene stands out so much. I think it has a lot to do with like the way the scene moves, and also the score, which I mean, the score throughout the whole movie is amazing. But
yeah, the score is absolutely epic in this too. Yeah, it's fantastic. Yeah.
But yeah, that scene stands out to me so much, because there is this almost like there's this dance between them that kind of starts really there, where you can feel like, even though she is like, even in that moment, resisting, and there is still this sense of like she doesn't really want to. And I don't know, that whole moment like still stands out to me as like something I still remember from watching it when I was young. And then it kind of came back to me when I was watching it for this. It's just a really cool moment between the two of them.
One of the moments for me whenever I watch it that's always iconic is that moment where Dracula is in the room with Harker, and the brides are there, and then he brings the baby out, and it's like,
yeah,
he's gonna eat the baby. I was like, dude, that's terrifying. His character looks so good in that, with that like kind of like old makeup still.
Yeah, it's so good.
Yeah, it's so, yeah. And again, like you mentioned before too, the score in this, and I believe it's Jerry Goldsmith, right? Am I correct?
No, I'm going to butcher this guy's name. It's W-O-J-C-I-E-C-H.
Wadrick Killar. Wadrick
Killar. There we go. Yeah. There we go.
Yeah. It's so good. It's so freaking good. The score is epic. The score is great. And then Annie Lennox does the end song, love song for a vampire at the very end. So she was obviously huge at that time. But this movie had the perfect storm of just you know, kind of early 90s, just, you know, cast, you know, music, people just kind of at their height of their powers. And like I said, it's there's so many iconic images from this film. Like I always remember too, when Dracula, and when he's the werewolf, is like looking up, yeah, and he's like blood on the fangs. And I'm like, there's just so many great horror moments in this that you still find imagery for everywhere, that kind of like still have a lasting memory, I think, in horror fans, like kind of mine. Now, at the same time, you also have the lasting memory of Keanu Reeves butchering an English accent, but that's, yeah. I mean, that's that's, yeah.
So poor guy. I mean, I went through, I couldn't find any review that liked him. I tried, and I couldn't find any. But what I did find too, and this is just a testament of who Keanu Reeves, I think, was and continues to be, because a lot of people still consider him like one of the nicest people in Hollywood. And Francis Ford Coppola, there was a quote or like that he mentioned, and he said that, like, you know, Keanu Reeves like tried to push to do the accent really hard. Like, he really wanted to like get it right. And he thinks that he pushed like himself too hard, that it sounded, you know, the way that it sounds in the movie. And Francis Ford Coppola was like, despite all that, he couldn't, like, he doesn't really think bad of him in the movie. And then I think he said something on the line like, and I still consider him like a prince to this day. So like, he's just such a nice person that even Francis Ford Coppola was like, yeah, if it didn't work, it didn't work. But he wanted to put it out there that he tried his damnedest to make it work, but he might have tried too hard, which might have made it come off not well.
I was going to say, the thing about it is too, is that, look, we've all heard numerous upon numerous stories about Keanu Reeves being just a great overall person, like, right? And so, right, it's hard to even judge the guy, because it's just, he sounds like a gracious, humble, and look, here's the thing too. There's some people who say Keanu Reeves isn't a good actor in general. I don't buy that. I think he's great. I thought he was fantastic.
He's been some stuff that I've really surprised me.
Yeah,
I don't know if you've ever seen The Gift. Like, that is he's really good in that.
He's great. He's great in that. I think he's great in the Matrix movies. I mean, I think he's great, yeah, in those films. Those films call for him to kind of be a nothing character and to be a cipher. And he does that. And I love him in Speed. I mean, there's a couple of movies that I'm just like, he's great. Point Break. You know, but the problem with this is like, when you watch it, it's just so much his performance, unfortunately, it tends to take you out of the film at times, because you could just tell that everyone is just kind of acting circles around him, and he's doing his absolute best. I'm not saying that he's not, he's totally doing his absolute best. It's just hard at times to watch, because you know that these performances are so kind of classical in nature, and that Reeves' acting is so different than that, that it just kind of clashes at times. But there's no doubt that he tried his best. There's no doubt he's a good person. So yeah, it's just one of those things that will always kind of, I think, live in infamy with this film, unfortunately.
Yeah, I think so too. And you know, and you made a good point. I think what makes it stand out the way it does is that he is surrounded by so many good actors that it makes it more clear that he's a bit out of his depth a little bit. And that becomes a detriment, because I think if I watched this with the wrong friend and they were just focused on him, they might think that it was like, is this supposed to be like parody or satire in some way? Like, they would start to make fun of it. And thankfully I haven't watched it with anyone that isn't like, I'm like, yo, pay attention to everything else, please. Just don't pay attention to him. And like you said, like, he does try his hardest. If I had to pick a moment where he is the most effective, I guess it is probably is in the scene that you mentioned with the brides and stuff, and when he reacts to him taking out the baby to basically, you know, like, to feed to them, pretty much. That's probably his best moment in the movie. But yeah, I mean, it's unfortunate. And he doesn't seem like the kind of person that would be, if he got beat up over it back then, that it would like really get to him. He probably just moved on to the next thing. But it would suck to stick out like the sore thumb amongst a bunch of other really great actors. I mean, I had a friend that doesn't think Winona Ryder is all that great in this. I disagree. I think she does a perfectly good job in it. You know, there's always this thing where, like, you know, American actors like put on like English accents and how good they sound. I think hers is perfectly fine, especially in comparison to his. Like, there's certain times where you hear him, you can say, okay, I can hear an American trying to do an English accent and it's not good. But yeah,
again, it's funny. It's funny you say that. Yeah, it's like I can see the criticisms occasionally of Winona Ryder's performance in this film of like, you know, certain moments. But I think overall her character, though, achieves what is supposed to be achieved. And I think that she does a great job of doing that. So it's not a situation for me where I feel like her character is ever taking me out of the film, if that makes sense. It's never a situation where I feel like, yeah, I can understand little nitpicky parts here and there where maybe it's not as like it's not as dramatic or it doesn't land the punch that maybe it needs to, but overall I think that she does a really good job in this movie. And again, it's her kind of chemistry with Oldman that I think works the best in the vein of like carrying over the theme.
Pulls her right back. Yeah, pulls her right back. I mean I'm not, you know, sometimes I'm not a fan of like narration and stuff like that. I think it might be necessary for certain movies, and you know, I think it's hard to make that sound good sometimes. So she has moments where she's narrating stuff where I was like, oh, that didn't sound all that great. But then like she pulls me back in when she's in a scene with him. And then I'm like, all right, no, she's doing a fine job. So yeah, I get it. There's like, I could be nitpicky about her in like little instances, but where she needs to really sell it, she does.
And yeah, I agree.
And that is in that relationship with him and like, you know, that kind of longing and like that feeling of being enticed, and like she sells that perfectly well that I can forgive like some clunky, like, you know, line readings of narration.
I couldn't agree more.
You brought up something interesting too about how that character kind of comes in and these women are kind of experiencing these kind of sexual feelings. I mean, like, you kind of see that with, like, you know, Lucy is a bit more free than Mina is. But it seems like these women are on the verge of like wanting to like experience more and feel more. And like, you know, that's something I didn't realize was a part of the movie until I was like got much older, right? Because I wasn't really paying attention to that. But it seemed like a focal point in the film where like this being is coming in where these women are at the stage of their lives where they want to be more free and they want to experience something more than what they are experiencing in their current lives. I thought that was an interesting angle too as well.
Yeah, no, I mean, and again, Sadie Frost, who plays Lucy, I think does a really good job. And
Very good movie.
and you know, we didn't even bring up a couple of the other people in this that I forgot about. Tom Waits plays Renfield, who's great. And then, you know, Monica Bellucci, who is absolutely gorgeous, is one of the of Dracula's brides, obviously now in Beetlejuice. But I mean, again, and I'm bringing these character actors up because, you know, these other players up because, again, I think everyone, the ensemble in this film is really A+. Like, I mean, it's strong. Everyone gives a great performance, but Sadie Frost as Lucy, I think, is great. I think she has that kind of yearning, that sexual energy kind of like, you know, coming out of her. And again, it's like this, the story of Dracula is just so seeped in this idea of like kind of you know, kind of Victorian era London and these women being kind of like castrated almost by like the system of oppression, you know, sexually that they're in. And then this character coming in who's kind of letting them feel all of this, but obviously he's evil. And so it's like, it's a very interesting dynamic. And again, what Coppola, I think, always did really well with this film is he knew that the heart of the movie was really about the fact that Dracula wanted to be loved and like he wanted to find someone to have for him because he's lived eternity effectively alone to this point. And so I think that's kind of the tragedy of the film. And then all of the horror elements obviously are the kind of the awesome window dressing we get. And that, you know, again, the makeup, the gore effects, the special effects on it are all fantastic, but it's like that, like you said, you mentioned that kind of like relationship between these women, I think is like kind of the crux of the film and why kind of like this story's been adapted so many times because it's you know, it's still happening. You can make a case it's still happening. So yeah,
for real, dude. Yeah, no, I agree. That is really it definitely is too. I do agree with that. And you know, I do love that those two women are so juxtaposed to each other. They're like, their personalities are so very different, but they are both like, you know, longing for the same things as well. And I do agree that he enters their lives where they are kind of in this place where they are kind of being castrated a bit. And like, they have these men that like think they're just there to be, you know, wed and like that kind of is it. And, and he, he offers them a bit more. I do think it's interesting too, though, like, you know, this person that is offering them this freedom is evil. So like, it almost like implies that in that day and age to have that kind of sexual freedom is an evil thing. I love that it speaks on so many different kind of things and themes, and just in the case of those two characters and those women and like the stages they are in their lives and what opens up for them when Dracula enters their lives as well.
I was gonna say too, the fact too that we have Dracula's character kind of renouncing God, right? And again, you know, in horror, it's like, you know, you have this idea, like throughout history, Dracula has like, oh, the cross is like kind of, you know, holy water and stuff. But what I loved in that opening, like you talked about the themes of just, he feels betrayed by God. That's the problem, right? Is that he thinks that God betrayed him and like left him to effectively have this horrible life and future because of the fact that his you know, bride died. And I thought that was, again, it's a very interesting juxtaposition that just makes Dracula's character much more thematically full to me and than other incarnations where we just have him kind of appear. It's the idea that he's always wanted revenge effectively, or he's wanted to avenge his kind of loss of life. And so yeah, that's it's a really fun kind of like idea. And I think one of the reasons that Dracula character feels just so iconic and full in this film.
Yeah. And I mean, I know, like, you know, most people when they're watching horror movies, they don't, you know, at the heart of this is a love story. And I know that that's why some people might be turned off by it, because it's not like a particularly scary movie or anything. It's not intended to be. It has more layers than that. And I think that's why I enjoyed it so much, because I want you, even if the characters are supposedly evil and all that, if there is some elements to them that where you can find a little like empathy for them, I think it makes them more interesting. And like, that is at the heart of it. This guy just wants to be loved, and what he wants is to find that love that he lost and that he doesn't believe that he deserved to lose. And that's why he is, you know, gone out of his way to find that again by any means necessary. So like, that part of the story is the most intriguing to me. This kind of like love at all costs thing that he is, you know, invested in.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, man. It's really it like I said, it's one of those things that, you know, Coppola nails the gothic romance aspect, I think, just so beautifully. And we don't, and again, we don't really have a lot of gothic horror films in the last 20, 30 years, even. I mean, like, I think about like Crimson Peak. I think about like a couple of these other films that are kind of like in that gothic vein. There's not a lot of them. And, you know, we're treated, I think, with this film of Coppola really hearkening, not only like adhering very much so to the book of Bram Stoker's Dracula, very kind of faithfully, but also kind of really kind of, you know, I'm a huge fan of like the Hammer horror films. I love that era of filmmaking in general. I love all of those, you know, the Christopher Lee, the Peter Cushing, Dracula, Frankenstein, Mummy movies. I love all of them. And I thought that this film, to me, it harkens a lot back to what those were, these grandiose productions, kind of like primarily English cast with full built sets and all of this, you know, kind of iconic makeup. And I just feel like that's what Coppola was able to do with this film, and imbuing it with that tragedy of like a Shakespearean kind of like, you know, essence to it, with like having Dracula be this tragic character and having there be a love story at the center. I thought it was just, we don't get a lot of movies like this. We just don't, because most of the time they're not sellable, but obviously because Dracula is still a hot commodity, you know, it was sellable, and it did really well at the box office. I mean, it killed at the box office, quite frankly.
Yeah, it did. I mean, I think when it opened, it actually, they said that it, they had the November record when it opened. It was a $30.5 million opening, which is kind of crazy now because opening weekends are insane today. But it beat Back to the Future 2's November opening record. And then it was quickly surpassed by Home Alone 2, Lost in New York, like soon after. It was like a couple weeks after.
Right.
It did really well globally. I think it was like $215.8 million worldwide. It actually got Francis Ford Coppola out of a little bit of debt that he was in, because it did so well at the time. You know, it's a shame that these kind of movies don't sell as well anymore. I mean, you made a good point that I think that's the main reason why we don't get them. I think that's why we got them in the wake of this, like for a little bit. You know, we kind of got like Interview with the Vampire, and then Kenneth Branagh did his take on Frankenstein and stuff. So I think that's why we did get them a lit. Like, it's like anything in Hollywood, when something hits, they're like, every studio is like, well, we want our own.
Correct.
That's seemed to be the case with this, but like, it's a shame. I think I wish people would, I think today's audiences just aren't used to kind of sitting down and like, this is, and having something more story driven than something that's more horror driven. Cause I think if this came out today, how they would market it fully would be, they would marker the horror element of it so hard. And then when people went to go see it, they would be like, oh, well, there's this love story buried in here. And, would they be able to sustain that beyond an opening weekend is, questionable today. But I think that's unfortunate because, there's some good storytelling and all that I think we're missing out on today.
I don't disagree with you. And you bring up a great point about the wake of films that came out after that too, because I mean, this film really was, I think, integral to Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, Interview with the Vampire, and a couple of these other films that came out in the wake of this movie that were in that same Victorian era gothic vibe. And those films, again, they did well for the most part. But in our modern filmmaking world, I think the real big question too is that what other directors could direct something like this? I mean, I think that's the other big question because, Coppola at that time, he had the cachet to effectively say, I can do kind of whatever I want. I mean, he did the Godfather trilogy. He had already done Apocalypse Now. I mean, he had done some massive, massive movies that had made the studios a lot of money. And so the studios, there's always there's that old additive, one for you, one for me, aka, right. I do one for the studio, then I get one back that's going to be a creative endeavor that I really want to do. And, right. This was the classic one for you, one for me, where it was actually one for both, where the studio made a ton of money and Coppola also got to do something extremely creative that was also kind of a period piece. I mean, again, this movie got nominated for Academy Awards. Like, when's the last time horror movies get nominated for Academy Awards? I mean, that's how kind of like in the zeitgeist this film was. And so, it's an interesting dynamic. And like, thinking about now, it's like, again, for me, Del Toro is the king of gothic, right? I think like Del Toro could do any kind of gothic film he wanted to do. He could do Creature. He could do Frankenstein. He can do Dracula. I don't care. He has the style. He has the cachet to do that, right? But, you now look at with Nosferatu, I mean, that's our next kind of chance to see if this kind of thing still works, because again, there's not a lot of directors working right now that, number one, I think even want to do this style of gothic kind of horror. And number two, have the cachet to be able to pull it off where the studios are going to give them the control needed to necessary to make this a full grand scale, amazing production. And even we saw with Crimson Peak, unfortunately, that film didn't really do well. And even though I think it's extremely cinematography wise and a lot of the acting's fun, Del Toro is not always the most bankable director in the world. He does stuff that's usually in more of a niche. And so I think this film was really a perfect storm of things hitting that I don't think we really get often at all in the entertainment world, where again, the source material, the acting, the director, the costuming, the special effects, the time period, everything kind of like had this perfect maelstrom where it not only was a massive success culturally, but it also was a critical success for the most part in terms of at least, getting nominated for some awards. And now you're seeing critical reappraisal. The movie's looked at very fondly, obviously.
Yeah, I think so too. And I mean, it was a perfect, I mean, like you have like the ensemble of that time that you really needed to have. You had a director who, revered and respected doing something like that, and doing a movie like this. I mean, I agree with you. I kind of wish, like, after seeing this multiple times, that Francis Ford Coppola would have done more movies like this, because he certainly has an eye for it. And I think we've probably been missing out on some very good like horror stories from him, because he pretty much proved that he could really sell a project like this. I would have loved to have seen more of this kind of style of filmmaking from him, especially after it having it hit the way it did. I mean, I know when you're a director like him, you don't want to all, you don't want to like repeat yourself and do the same thing over and over again. You want to move on to the next thing. But like, this was a really good example that he could do it and do it well.
Well, and I was going to say too, you know, we talk about Coppola wanting to do more stuff, but I mean, Gary Oldman really has never done any more horror besides this. I mean, he's done fun films that are like kind of like adjacent. You know, he did obviously Batman, and he's done some other kind of, you know, things. But his character, I'm saying like who he actually plays, he hasn't really done anything horror related since then. So this is kind of one of his only major iconic horror roles, which is a shame because, again, he's a phenomenal actor. Now, obviously, we got Winona Ryder, who went back into genre, and she's kind of lived in genre most of her career, to be fair. She's not necessarily Scream Queen per se, but she's definitely, you know, a iconic figure within horror. And then you have, you know, Anthony Hopkins, who obviously has an iconic performance as one of the greatest serial killers of all time. And you have a couple of these characters, but it's a shame we never got more out of Oldman after this film, because again, his performance is so good that you're like, man, I would love to see him do something else. I guess we did get him in Hannibal. We did get him as Mason Vernon. We did get him in that, but it was a little bit different. But you know, since then, it's not been a lot, unfortunately. So it's like I said, this was really a pinpoint in time that I feel like they just got everything right. And I still think that's part of the reason it lives on so hard, is because there was so many stars brimming with this that, you know, I look at now and I'm thinking like, who would be the Winona Ryder now? Would it be Sydney Sweeney? Yeah. Jenna Ortega? I don't know about that. I'm like thinking about like who is iconic enough right now to pull off.
They have like that, like when Florence Pugh.
Florence Pugh could do it. I could see that. That would actually, or Anna Taylor Joy. Anna Taylor Joy.
She'd be pretty good.
Yeah.
But all the other roles too. I mean, yeah, there's so many. I mean, like I can't think of like who I would want to even tackle the Dracula role. Like currently, like thinking in the same way that they could do it the way Gary Oldman did it.
Well, that's the thing, is that again, we have the new Nosferatu with Skarsgård, which I'm like, right, cool, right. this will be fun. But really thinking about, like, you know, again, an actor who has the cachet, who has been really not any genre roles, because he didn't do really any genre roles, so at the cachet, and then was going to walk into doing this role. I don't know. I'm not sure who you would even, Glenn Powell. I'm being serious. Glenn Powell, maybe. I don't know. He seems more suited to be one of the Americans, to be honest. But it's a hard road to walk. I think at this point where we look at the current landscape and we're like, I don't know who would be fit in here.
But you know, it's interesting you mentioned Glenn Powell, because it seems like Glenn Powell is on the same movie star trajectory that Tom Cruise was when he started. And I know that they are very much like, they're very close. And it seems like Glenn Powell like looks at him as a mentor. But that made me just think of like early Tom Cruise and him doing Interview with the Vampire, and like no one thinking that he could, is particularly Anne Rice was like very upset when he got cast. And then he proved everyone wrong, and then proved her so wrong that she, you know, wrote him a public letter of apology because she was so wrong about him. So, I mean, I guess like it is possible that like some of those people you named could do that, and like we'd be surprised by it. But Gary Oldman definitely hit a certain note here. And I think also too, what makes this movie stand out with this cast and the people that are in it, and it's not a typical horror film, right? There's a bit more prestige to it because of who's attached to it. I think that makes a lot of people who are like leery of doing horror films, when there is a bit more of a class behind it, that makes them want to feel like they're comfortable enough to do it. I think this movie had that, which made a lot of people want to be associated with it. I think that really helped and worked in his favor.
But, and I was going to say, I mean, again, once you have a director like Coppola attached, everyone's going to want to be involved at that point, right? Like, that's the thing, is that, like, you know, you get the man with the vision and everyone wants to be involved with it. And that's what I was saying, is like, I, you know, when we talk about directors who truly have the vision and are, are, are working today. It's a short list. I mean, it really is. There's only, you know, there's not many that I think would even attempt to helm this kind of project. And that's why I'm really curious to see how Nosferatu does, because to me, I'm like, well, this is kind of like the basis test. If this works, then, you know, like you said, Hollywood's a copycat, you know, business, and there's going to be potential copycats sprouting out because of that. But there's just not a lot of people working today that have the cachet that Coppola had back then. And it's going to be one of those things. And that's partially because the studio system has changed. And, you know, we don't have as many stars anymore like we used to. Like, it's, yes, we do have some people that are instantly recognizable, but it's not nearly as much as it was back then when this whole cast got together. And they had this many, kind of like big names attached. It would be like the equivalent of like having like, you know, every big name actor from right now in their 40s, 50s being in a movie. I mean, and with a couple of younger women. So it would be a really huge thing. And for them to do a horror movie too, everyone would be like, what? You know, it's a very strange thing. And it's one of those things I think that kind of, again, it helps the legacy of this film, I think, overall, because you just don't really see this ever happening in kind of like the modern entertainment sphere, and especially not in modern cinema as we have it now with everything releasing to streaming. This was a big theatrical release. This was a big event piece that, you know, everyone really like was, you know, again, it made a lot of money because of the fact that all of these stars were attached, the director, the source material, everything involved with it, you know?
Yeah. I have this quote from Neil Jordan, who did Interview the Vampire, and why he felt comfortable doing that. He said, up to that point, Francis Ford Coppola with Bram Stoker's Dracula, he introduced opulence and theatricality. Normally before that one, I always thought of vampire movies as cheap, cobbled together, brilliant use of minimal resources. Francis made it this epic thing. So when I was given the opportunity to make Interview the Vampire, I thought, oh, it'll be really great to expand on that epic sense of darkness and to give these characters huge kind of romantic destinies and longings and feelings. So yeah, that really wasn't, I mean, I you know, it's so crazy too, because I didn't really think about that until I thought about the movies that came out after this when I was like looking it up. And I was like, yeah, that really, it really did kind of set this new thing for a little bit that people were like, oh, we need our big opulent prestige, like horror movie adaptation of like classic, you know, horror movie monster.
Well, and I was going to say too, right on the money, but I was going to say too, adjusted for inflation as of 2023, this movie would have made $473 million, making it one of the highest grossing vampire movies of all time. So, I mean, like, that's just crazy. I mean, yeah. So again, imagine nowadays, you know, again, that number of a vampire movie coming out, people would have been going bonkers for sure. And again, like we still see a lot of the Dracula's armor, his like, you know, red armor. We still see that being cosplayed. Yeah. We still see like that steampunk aesthetic from the film being cosplayed. There were so many iconic images in this film. It really is one of those movies that I think for a lot of people too, when they were a little bit older than both of us who were in there, you know, who were in between 10 and 15, they're watching this movie like, oh my God, this is like the grand opera of horror right here. Like this is like, there's so many insanely iconic images. And not only that, but the cast is just, you know, all of these people that they, you know, looked up and revered. Yeah, I see it. I see why the kind of the fervor around this film was so big at the time, because again, no one had really done anything like this. It was really game changing. And again, like I said, Coppola, his history, we all know, it's like, it's just, he is a visionary in that way. And when he got cooking on something like this, it was, you knew it was going to be great.
Yeah, I agree. And I think that's why it still holds up today. I was really glad that that was one that you had a lot of great choices there. But I was like, I hadn't watched this one in a while. I want to like dive back into it, and it holds up really well. I mean, you can nitpick any movie and be like, oh, like this, you would change this and that. But I think for the most part, it still resonates and it looks great. I mean, it won the Academy over Best Costume Design, Best Makeup, and Best Sound Editing, which is much deserved. For its time, it looked great then, and I think a lot of the stuff that all the look of it now still holds up really well. And you know what? It made me miss kind of this kind of romanticized version of this character a bit, because I don't think we've really had that in a really long time. And I don't know if they think that kind of version of the character will sell anymore, but this was a nice throwback to that. And just to see that kind of storytelling again. And I also like that, you know, yeah, it is serious in parts, but there is some humor in it too, mostly courtesy of like Anthony Hopkins, Van Helsing, who has some really funny lines as well to kind of break up some of the more like serious stuff that's going on. I forget how the line goes exactly, but when they're talking about what he needs, and they think they're talking about like an autopsy for Lucy, and he talks about like basically like chopping off her head, and he says it so like matter of factly, and like it's just so great. I love that, like, you know, there's a little mix of that in there because I think you need a little bit of levity, but it doesn't distract from the movie either. So I think that also helps that you have an actor of like Anthony Hopkins caliber being the one to do that, because it doesn't completely take away from like the most important parts of the story too.
No, I couldn't agree more. It's, you got to have a little bit of that levity. Again, the you know, having Hopkins playing that role. I mean, again, it's hard for me at this point to see anyone else play that role. It really is. He really kind of is like one of the quintessential. He's, if Oldman is a top three Dracula, he's a top three Van Helsing. He gives one of those really iconically awesome performances of that character that I think is has very rarely been matched. And like I said, he has some really fun kind of moments within the film and lines, and yeah, he's just absolutely phenomenal. I always love watching him, but he's great in this movie. He's truly fantastic.
Yep. Before we wrap it up, I do want to maybe see if you can mention, because we both mentioned in the beginning that there is some like hammy acting in it, but I don't want to like make anyone think that as a detriment. So how would you describe the performances here and how people should like view them? I mean, I know we talked about Keanu Reeves and maybe he's an outlier, we can maybe leave him out of this part of it, but everyone else, when you say hammy, you're not even saying that, we're not saying it as like a diss or an insult. It's just
a product.
It's just a product of the time period, product of like when it's supposed to be set and all that too. Yeah. So yeah, if you can explain that a little bit more. Yeah.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, I'd love to. Yeah. I mean, I think the biggest thing for me when it comes to these performances is that it's very classical. It's very like, and when I mean hammy, I mean like, you know, typically a Shakespearean actor, you know, like might ham up a performance, but it's in the way that it's hammy in the vein of it totally fits the vibe of what you want from this film, which is like this very dark, brooding, gothic, old England, you know, like this idea of, you know, Anthony Hopkins being like, she's with Terrasol apart, you know, yelling at them, and then you have, you know, Dracula with his lines like listen to them, the children of the night, you know, you have these really great interpretations of these very iconic lines, but they're done in a way that's a little bit hammy in the vein of they're playing to the camera, they're playing to us as viewers in a vein that a great legendary stage actor might play to us, you know, with an iconic role. And that's that's part of the reason I love this movie. I'm being serious when I say that. I love that. Again, I'm a big Hammer horror fan. I'm a big Universal monster fan. But those films had that. They had that cachet of playing a little bit hammy to the camera, playing a little bit of like, we know that this is a great line and we're really going to sell it. And like, I think that's part of what makes this movie great. Like, like I said, you know, Keanu Reeves' performance might not be fantastic, but everyone else knows the objective. They know their job in this film. They know exactly what they're doing, which is we're playing a kind of stylized version of this English kind of, you know, world, and Dracula's in it. And they know exactly what they're doing with that. So,
yep. And I think you hit the nail on the head. Like, it feels like a stage play. It feels like they're playing everything big. And that's how a lot of like theater actors are as well. I would just say like the best way to describe it is that I think everyone understood the assignment, and that is like that is the best way to put it. And I agree. I love how like dramatic the whole thing is too. I think that adds a lot to the appeal. Like it, and by the way, it takes good actors to sell that without it being like, oh, that was really cheesy and that was really bad. Because like the whole time I was never like, oh, this is taking me out of it. If anything, it brings me into it more. The more dramatic it was, it was just like, oh, it you felt the importance of every word and situation that they were put in, and that helps with like, you know, having those kind of performers know exactly what parts they're playing and what world that this their characters are living in. And I think that sells it completely too.
I couldn't agree more. That's exactly what it is, and it takes great actors to know that. It really does. You can have those situations where they're not knowing what they're doing, but everyone here, for the most part, they understood the assignment. Coppola told them this is going to be a little over the top. It's going to be a little bit kind of stage play, soap opery, but that's exactly what I want, and it rings through the whole thing. So yeah.
Yeah, I agree. Well, any parting words for me? Like, if anyone hasn't seen it, if anything you want to say that would maybe convince them to see the film?
Yeah, I think. I mean, first off, if you haven't seen this movie, what are you doing? I'm kidding.
Get it together.
Yeah. No, I absolutely love this film. I think that during spooky season, this is one of this is an absolutely fantastic watch. I love, for me at least, and I'll quickly say this, for people who have not watched this film, I love to watch these kind of classical horror films right in the middle of the month, because I feel like the air is a little bit crisper. I feel like we have the pumpkins out now, we've got the lights, and there's just something about watching like the Universal Monsters, the black and white, the Hammer horror films, the Bram Stoker's Dracula, like this color palette, this kind of gothicness that really puts you in the Halloween mood. So I say watch it anytime you want to, but specifically like between like that middle, those 2 weeks in October and in the thick of Halloween season, this is just a great one, an absolutely phenomenal one to watch. I promise you will not be disappointed.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And I think he hit the nail on the head about when you should watch it. It really does. Yeah, that kind of vibe during that point of the month would be the perfect time to watch this. And also it might surprise you, I won't say who this friend is on the show because he will get embarrassed, but he didn't know that Francis Ford Coppola directed this. He was like, wait, what? And he had seen it a couple times, just didn't pay attention to it. It was like on TV. And he was like, I had no idea he did that. Like, that's so weird. Cause like, you know, you think of Coppola, you think of The Godfather and Apocalypse Now, right? And he was like, well, my point is that it feels like it sticks out, not in a bad way, but like as a sore thumb and like that filmography, like I wouldn't expect that from him. But I think that's the cool thing, is that maybe you wouldn't. And that's what makes it so enticing and so good.
Yeah.
And yeah. So completely surprising effort for him at the time. And I'm glad that it's definitely gotten reappraised in like recent years too, as like, you know, one of his films that you should revisit and stands up pretty, you know, highly in his filmography. So yeah, I mean, I'm so glad you picked it. I was really happy to talk about it. Also, when guests are on, it's so nice when it's easy and the conversation goes smoothly. And this is one of those circumstances. So thank you so much for being a good guest.
Of course. And, of course.
And hey, the conversation is so much fun and easy as well. Just to reiterate, where can everyone find your show? If you want to name
yes.
it, and of course, we'll link it yes. on the description, but like just so they want to hear it again.
Yeah, of course, guys. Yeah, if you want to find more, again, this is an anthology horror podcast. We do full cast, so there's like a couple of actors in each episode with full music, full sound. It's called Your Horror Show. Yeah. Y-O-U-R horror show. It's very much based upon like Tales from the Crypt, Twilight Zone. So if you're into those anthologies, if you're into those kind of stories, you will absolutely love it. Hopefully you listen. Looking forward to you guys checking it out. So thank you. And thank you for having me on. It was really a pleasure. It was super fun.
Oh, no problem, man. And, you know, like the whole Tales of Horror thing is going on in the next 2 months. We also have like a deep dive spinoff that's built into our main show. I will take any excuse to talk about horror movies, even if it isn't the month of September and October. So if you ever want to do another deep dive, I'm fully down, because like, I don't know, you made this conversation so easy, man. So I would love to jump into another movie with you and discuss it for sure.
Yeah, that sounds great. We'll talk about it. That sounds super fun.
Yeah, for sure. And guys, as always, if you want to listen to Back to the Blockbuster, you can find us wherever you get your podcasts, whether it's Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Good Pods. Those are all really great, but we have a podcast network called Playlist Studios, and they have an app to listen to our shows. You can get it in the iOS store or in the Google Play store. Check them out. They are very good to us. They help edit the show. They do a lot of heavy lifting when we can't do it on our own. So we want to help them out as much as they help us out as well. You can also find the show on YouTube and subscribe if you want to see some of our pretty faces, if you want to do that as well too. We have a lot more Tales of Horror coming up for you. The next one's going to be something completely different, doing a twofer in this. It's Jennifer's Body and the Sorority Row remake. So that'll be fun, because I haven't watched those in a while either. And that's why this is so fun. So I can talk about Bram Stoker's Dracula one day and then a sorority row slasher film the next. So that's also fun as well. So as always, look out for those future episodes. Again, thank you, Ryan, for joining us. It's been a pleasure. And until next time, guys, we'll catch you later. Peace.